So now we have one very interesting panel discussion once again. Let's hear financial services industry on Better Together. So reinvigorating advisors and distributors by modernizing delivery channels. This panel discussion would be moderated by Mr. Deepak Jain, Director, FM India. We have our esteemed panelists with us, and I'm very proud and privileged to welcome all of you, sir. We have K.S. Rao, sir, Head, Investor Education and Distribution Development, ABSL AMC. Namaskar, sir. So we have Mr. Babu Krishnamurthy, President, IFA Galaxy. We have Mr. Lavai Navlakhi, MD and CEO, International Money Matters. We have Mr. Suresh Sadagopan, SEBI RIA Founder, Ladder 7 Financial Advisories. We have Mr. Vishal Dhawan, SEBI RIA Founder, Plan Ahead Wealth Advisors. A very warm welcome to all the speakers. So thank you so much for accepting our request to be on the forum today and share. I'm sure this would be a very powerful panel discussion with having all of you here once again. Thank you so much. A very warm welcome once again, sir. I will just check with Mr. Babu for him also to join.
So let me start this discussion by putting a question to somebody who has been a great lightning force for AFM India, Mr. Rao, sir. And the question is, how have you seen financial distribution evolve over time since you joined the industry?
Good afternoon, Deepak, and good afternoon to everyone. It's great to be part of a esteemed panel of Lavai sir, Vishal ji, and Suresh ji. Honored to be part of this panel. And I'm an optimist. I'm an eternal optimist, Deepak. I think when things are evolving, I think our distribution has evolved during the tough times. And crisis was an opportunity. Crisis was a fertilizer for our distribution. I've seen from 2001 when the certification started coming in to the no load era to director and today it's RIAs and MFD models. I look at it's evolving, and those who are serious in the business are always growing. And I look at it's a bright future, and we always evolve with the things coming in. I think that's the best part of it. In the last 10 years, if I can see the best of today's top 100 distributors, the way last 10 years to today, I think they would have gone by at least 10 to 12x. That's where the opportunity of growth available to.
Right, sir. Right, sir. And I'd like to bring in other distinguished panelists also into Mr. Lavai. What are your views when you joined this industry until today? What have been the changes and how have they impacted the way you are giving advice?
I think there have been very positive changes, and the growth has been quite phenomenal. I think the one thing that has been constant is that we are continuously learning. We keep sort of changing what our sort of outlook is. And I think in a large way, I suppose that while we have also been impacted with the change in regulation or the change in the way media has helped make sure that investors become aware about advice, etc. I think overall it's been a really good journey, and I think there's a lot yet for us to learn. So looking forward to the future of this industry as well.
Great, sir. Vishal sir, when did you join the industry and how did it evolve over the period?
So it's been about 18 years now, so it's been a long while. I used to have a lot more hair than I have today. So essentially what we've seen over this period of time is clearly I think there has been periods where as distributors or advisors, we've been ahead of the curve and ahead of regulation, and there have been periods where we have been behind, and therefore there's been a bit of catch up to do. And I think that's going to continue to be something that all of us in the industry will have to battle with. I think the good news is that every time you're trying to catch up with something, it means you're moving forward. It's very rare that you move backward catching up with something. So I think as long as we all look at it from the perspective that we are all moving forward ahead, sometimes faster, sometimes a little slower, I think we can see this very, very phenomenally bright future, because the penetration of advice in our country and the penetration of financial products in our country vis-a-vis the amount of money which lies around in physical assets, is so, that gap is so large that, you know, the opportunity is unimaginably large. And I think it's only our imagination which will kind of hold us back to the level that we want to be at.
Great. Mr. Sadagon, your views, how did you start and how has it evolved over the years?
So over a period of time, there has been a realization that there are two kinds of people who are needed in the financial services space. Rightly so, at one point in time, we had distributors who were actually a function of full-scale financial advisory. They were distributing products, and that is what was there probably 10 years back. And SEBI had thought about this scenario, and they wanted to create a new class of advisors who will do other things apart from distributing products. And so that kind of class also got created. And slowly over a period of time, we have evolved and we are into purely an advisory mode. Most of us are purely in an advisory mode. So I think we are in the evolving state as of now. I would definitely say there is complete relevance for the distribution fraternity and even more relevance for the advisory fraternity. Like Vishal pointed out some time back, I think the opportunity in both spaces are enormous, and we have probably only scratched the surface. When I joined the industry, I remember it was under 3 lakh crores as far as the mutual fund AUM is concerned, probably much less than that. Now we are talking about some 28 lakh crores, and I see various figures and projections which I completely agree with. Probably in a matter of 10 years, we'll be crossing 10 lakh crores. Sorry, 100 lakh crores, I'm sorry. So, I mean, we are really on to very, very big growth, whichever side of the spectrum we happen to be in, whether we are into distribution or whether we are into advisory. And having said that, in both the cases, there are challenges and there are huge opportunities, and the way we interact with our clients are changing. I think one of the things which we will be discussing going ahead in future is going to be on that.
Thanks a lot for that enlightening thing. Now my next question is, what does the new age customer demand from their financial product distributor advisor? And how are we really giving what they demand? And this question is to Mr. Lavai.
I think for that, the customer has to answer that question more. But I think that what has changed and what we are seeing continuously happening is that India has moved to this stage in the last couple of decades of people having a wealth, nuclear families, and this increased awareness about financial products and the fact that, you know, people do need to plan for their money and use advisors. I think that's one part. And the other part is that as the knowledge has increased, the whole, I would say the whole population of people who are consuming these products has also changed and evolved. In the early days, it was only people with wealth who were wanting to invest. Now it is people who are wanting to get wealth who are starting to invest, people who are aspiring. So you are certainly seeing that you have to not only deal with the 45, 50 and 60 year olds who would earlier invest, but now even with the 20 year old, and in some cases, even with the 10 and 15 year olds who are starting to be interested about managing money. And for the parents who are wanting to encourage them to understand how to invest. So I think you suddenly have to deal with multiple channels, multiple ways of communication. And I suppose the confusion, if any, in the minds of the intermediary is that which segment should I deal with? Is there only one segment? Because there's opportunity in each and every segment. And I think that probably is the key as you go forward, that if you are able to segment who your client is, then you can figure out what's the delivery mechanism, and then you can say that, yes, I am delivering what that particular segment of mine wants in the way that they want it.
Great, sir. My next question is to Mr. Rao. Are we moving a physical advisor to virtual advisor? And will the old population be ready for a virtual advice? Are we prepared for it?
Okay, Deepak, I think it's a fantastic question to analyze and go by it's to look at it. But I'll go by the previous answer by Mr. Lowai. I think when the investor is evolving, whether you are a virtual advisor or physical advisor, I think investor will accept first part of it. Second, virtual advisor doesn't mean that you are always a robo advisor. Today I am an MFD, today I am an RII. I am available to my customer as a virtually. That's where the customer will acceptance. It's like earlier it was a high touch, probably now high tech is adding to my high touch advisory. And I'm not very sure if your question is focusing only on the advisor, virtual advisory. If it is a robo, probably customer is not fully evolved, not all the customers are evolved towards it. But in the larger platform, if I can look at as an MFD or as an RIA, if I look at this virtual, I mean, you know, I am available to them, but I'm virtually available to them. Both sides, it is there. It is a combination of these two. I think, you know, earlier we used to call digital. Probably today it is, I'm not going physically to them, but I know my technology, my platform will support my customer. At the same time, I'm available for hand-holding. That's where, you know, Vishalji or Rasureshji and Lawai, I think, you know, they are already evolved in that space. It's a living examples they have done. It's a much before COVID. I think each of them on the technology platforms, which are much more evolved. If you can look at Mr. Lowai's platform, it's highly connected to the customer. And most of the transactions have happened on the virtual platform, but the person is available to you to connect and do it. I think this is where the things are evolving and most of them will follow now.
Great, sir. Next question is to Mr. Vishal. And it's a very pertinent question from the distributors who are there. And the question is, how do you identify your competitive edge as an advisor? And how do you play it out in the field?
So I think, you know, it's a question that probably needs to get answered in two parts. One is, you know, what do you define in your client segment as what is hygiene versus what is, you know, truly a differentiator? And I think what we've seen is over the years that one of the hygiene factors that used to somehow get, you know, interpreted as a competitive edge used to be a word called service. And it's a very generic word because it could mean different things to different people. To someone who's expecting high returns on his portfolio, service gets equated to high portfolio returns. To someone who expects service being always available on the phone, he interprets it as, you know, he can call you at 12 at midnight and you still answer his call. To someone who's, you know, looking for deeper, you know, financial planning kind of advice, he's assuming that, you know, you are able to, you know, create a high quality plan for him. So I think it was a very ubiquitous kind of broad word, which I think needs to get broken down into individual components. And that's what I'm going to try to attempt to do right now for the community. So I think there's the customer has evolved away from access to a financial product. I think today access to a financial product has become very simple. Information about a financial product has become very simple. I think what we have to do, whether we are calling ourselves distributors or advisors, is be able to convert that data and information into advice, which means that it's actionable by the investor to help him or her achieve an objective that he set out for himself. And the second is the ability for the contextuality of that advice to come in. So I'm going to try to give an example of this. So we've had a big IPO, you know, close out yesterday, right? And we saw a lot of demand come in for that IPO, lots of noise around it because it's a, you know, QSR restaurant, right? And therefore, without trying to say whether it's good or bad, I think the demand for the product was, you know, very high. I think the opportunity really was around whether one has the ability to be able to help your client figure out, first of all, whether the product is appropriate. And secondly, most importantly, whether it's appropriate for him or her, rather than, you know, his friend or his colleague at work or somewhere else. So I think for all of us, I think we'll have to evolve into a situation where we become clear that we are actually putting contextuality, taking financial products, refining them, taking that information and data available, converting it into a into, you know, high quality actionable items, and then delivering it out. And then subsequent to that is how we get compensated for it, whether we charge a fee, whether we earn a distribution commission. I think those are all subsequent questions. Sometimes, you know, we've seen that the conversation actually starts with the compensation, and, you know, all of this kind of is in the background. I think we need to just reverse it out, and we are in a good place.
Great, sir. Great. My next question is to Mr. Sadgopan, and it's a question which is often asked to us also. In this fast changing regulatory environment, how to protect your business and clients?
So I think the in your question, the client is coming last. I would say by putting clients first, client front and center, I think that is the way we can go forward. Whether we are in the distribution business or whether we are in the advisory business, the client is at the center of everything. Okay, so once upon a time, like Vishal just pointed out, once upon a time, access to information was a challenge. So now access to information is not a challenge. Transactions at one point in time was a big thing. So transaction is just a couple of clicks now. So those things are not really that very important. The client is looking at other things from the advisor or the distributor. So they want somebody to know them quite well intimately. And we need to be able to understand the client requirements and needs properly. We need to be able to interact and ferret out the information that we require from the clients, so that we are able to advise them or appropriately give appropriate products for them to meet their goals. So the client should be at the focus, and if we keep clients at the focus, irrespective of what happens from the regulatory front, irrespective of any changes in the compensation mechanism and things like that, even if a distributor is migrating to an advisory, the client will stay intact, and the business will be disrupted, but it will not be disrupted to such an extent where they will have to go out of business. So I see the future to be very, very, glorious for both distributors and advisors, as long as we keep client front and center.
Great, sir. So my next question is to Mr. Rao, and the question is, how is marketing of financial advice and products changing over the period, and what do you see the future?
Okay, I think, you know, I'm not looking at any changes, and the products always will be pushed. And it's all that's where you have a necessity of an advisor, necessity of a distributor who is guiding to you. And over a period of time, yeah, things are evolving very faster. I think earlier, in one of the questions, Vishalji was talking about the yesterday's demand for the product. That always evolves, but you know, it's whether it suits to your client, that is the one which the distributor suits. A distributor comes into the place. And this, I personally feel the financial advisor profile is one of the best profiles. It's a life's greatest blessings, because you are serving someone. As Sureshji said, if you put the client's interest first, whichever way things are evolving, the distributor can always look at his customer's business. Customer's portfolio is the foremost important, and customers creating the wealth for the customer is foremost important. I'm not looking at, I think marketing was there earlier. We are always, now there could be a little bit of innovation. We could have been a little more pushy, and the digital platforms may be helping us to reach out very differently, but it's only creates an awareness, and the customer to choose, it is the advisor or the distributor who decides on that.
Great. And so this is, has been my favorite question to ask to each one of you. What are the problems when faced when you give out an estate planning advice or an estate planning communication with a client? Because we see a lot of inertia from the clients when it comes to actually implementing that advice. And what are your suggestions to overcome that inertia? And I'll start by asking Mr. Lavai.
Yeah, I think that, you know, unfortunately, every human being thinks that he's immortal while he knows that he's mortal. And he keeps pushing this problem back. I think one possible reason is that the whole concept of creation of an estate plan, etc., is relatively new. In the earlier days, it didn't really, it wasn't something that people were comfortable talking about, culturally talking about. What happens in case of death, you would never use that word. because if you somebody felt that okay, you had a black tongue, and then somebody will actually die because you mentioned the word death. I think nowadays there is a lot more awareness, but because there is no sort of, I would say, experience that you can rely on, saying okay, what did my sort of forefather do in terms of creating an estate plan? Pretty much every sort of family which is setting it out now is doing it, from a clean slate. And yes, there are people and there are experts available who can help create, and guide the people through this process. But as soon as then you agree that you first there's that mental block, then you get over it and say, okay, now I want to go about doing it. The next question that comes is, here is one checklist. Please put down all your assets that you have. So one, the information is not necessarily all easily available. So it takes a while to get that. Then you say, okay, please find us for the will. First and foremost, even if you are doing that, who is going to be the executor? And then there is one debate happening around, who that executor could be. Which family it should be from, should it be an external third party, should it be a family member, etc. So I think there is a whole bunch of, inertia that you mentioned around it because of these various reasons. Now, the only way that this could get pushed is that if people got evidence and got stories and examples of what happened in a situation when A was not done or B was not done. In our financial planning world, we speak about asset allocation, and being in the right asset class will generate the maximum possible return for you rather than choosing which fund, etc. So getting started with even a simple will document as the first step, and then having the ability to keep reviewing it and upgrading it from time to time is probably the way forward. And I think there needs to be a lot more push about this and creation of awareness about this.
Sadgopan sir, your views on this?
Sorry?
So your views on estate planning and initial surrounding estate planning?
So what Lovai said is absolutely true. A lot of people are not very, very keen on confronting that mortality. So that is really a problem. So what we do is that while understanding the client, we have several discussions with the client before we do a financial plan and during the financial planning process. So during that process itself, we drip down into their consciousness regarding what we are going to do right now and what they are going to do for their children by the financial plan that they are creating, and about the legacy that they want to leave, because all these things anyway get discussed. At the time of actually making a will or at the time of actually creating a trust, these people do demur. So it's not that they implicitly accept what we are saying. So there still needs to be a push. So during the conversation which we have with the client, we have kind of these story sessions where we talk about what happened to X and what happened to Y. We are hoping that the client will understand what happened to X can also probably happen to them. And that kind of a story approach has really helped in making people aware and understand the implications of what can happen to their family if they were not around. So that kind of an approach we have found to be very useful in pushing the clients to do the right thing as far as estate planning is concerned, be it a will, be it a trust, be it anything.
Great. And Vishal sir, I know that you have been very successful helping your clients move into estate planning. So any particular way you are using, which is a little different? Or
so I won't say very different, but I think we've tried to simplify it in terms of defining the financial plan as a plan A and a plan B. So plan A focuses on what if everything goes right, and a plan B is what if everything goes wrong, and therefore how you covered in both of these situations. So clearly the plan A is about wealth creation, about how your money gets managed, etc. And the plan B is about risk management, ensuring you have insurance in place, estate planning in place, etc. Because I think most people understand plan A and plan B very easily. They do it all the time. If they want to get from one part of Bangalore or Mumbai to another part, they always have a plan A or a plan B, even after the pandemic is on, or even in Delhi. And the same way, you know, they do it with their financial life. So we found that if you can simplify some of these concepts, in fact, you know, we think one of the services that all of us could probably do in India is replace the word estate plan with succession plan. Because estate plan in India sometimes gets confused with real estate plan.
Right.
And, I think the more we talk succession plan, I think the easier people find it to deal with. And I therefore think there's a need for simplicity around estate planning. It's made very complicated by all of us because we, you know, we feel that we can justify a fee for everything that we complicate, and you know, it's normally exactly the opposite that all of us know works well. Because if we can simplify, like Lobai said, you know, can you break a estate plan or a succession plan into an element like a starting off of a will and then go to bigger things, I think it becomes much easier to do. So I think, you know, going step by step is very useful, and I think that's worked very well for us.
Great, sir. So I am running out of time. Are there any questions?
Deepak, I would like to add something on the succession planning.
Yes, sure.
Like, a lot of good work is done by the our good friends like Lovai sir or Vishalji or Sureshji, but it is a time for us to take this to the masses. It's I fully agree with Vishalji's comment on simplifying that and re-nominicating. You know, it's a can I make it from estate planning to succession planning? In fact, I used to keep a term for them. You have done many SIPs to accomplish your goals. This is one SIP you can't forget to do it. That is your succession and inheritance planning. You know how you can do it. And thanks to Deepak and the team, we have taken forward across to the MFDs now. We are running a program on chartered succession and estate planning for the MFDs. And like, you know, this is the time we need to go back and tell everyone, because COVID has made us to realize that we know everything is temporary, but COVID has reinforced that temporary is permanent now. And it's the time for us to look at succession planning very serious. And every investor, if we can get that done, probably one, that will help us to serve the investor well. Second, it is also helping us to get more clients and the full wallet share of the client.
Great. Now, sir, I have one question which is open to all participants. And the question is, if the client has limited money, what would you advise him to take first, a personal accident policy, term plan, or a health plan? He can buy only one of them.
I'll probably go with health plan.
Okay. Anybody else who has some other view?
So I think, you know, this is actually a question about probabilities, right? And clearly the probability of falling sick is higher than the probability of dying for all of us. And therefore, just like investing is about probabilities, I think this question is also about, you know, how you define probabilities and kind of come out with outcomes. So I would also go with health.
Great.
I think health is the foremost important one. Have a health plan and plan for good health. Then you can make more wealth. Then you can start investing it.
And the second one, after health, out of the three?
I think.
A term plan or personal accident? Then,
very, very clearly it will be a term plan after medical insurance. Personal accident will be a kind of a subset of term insurance. So I would first go for a term insurance after medical insurance. And if there's enough money to go around, then probably we may also consider personal accident after that.
Great, sir. Great. So we have many students who have joined in also, and I think that question came from one of them. So it's great to hear that they are now thinking on these terms and trying to figure out what best to do. Great, sir. Great. That was a great answer.
I just want to add, Deepak, to that, you know, what Vishal spoke about probability. For the student, possibly if they are traveling on two-wheeler, etc., then they think personal accident may be the higher probability. But I think the other aspect to consider is impact cost. What happens if that low probability event happens? Then the impact is a lot more if you have a term plan. So maybe a combination of probability and impact cost is what you need to consider.
So can you simplify that for them?
So I'm saying in case of loss of life, then you have available at all to earn whatever you are earning, and your family had various goals that they needed to achieve based on your earning. If you are the earning member and you stop earning permanently, the loss is a lot more than if you stop earning for 3 months if you are unwell. Then you can get that portion somehow and get it back. But you know, if you're not there at all, then the family suffers. So that's what I meant by the impact.
Right, right. So, I think I need to now thank all of you, because it's been a great session. It is a lot of learning, and I think this would really help our participants to plan more their business and finances forward. Over to you, Dimple.
Yeah, so as Deepak sir rightly said, it is definitely a power-packed discussion for our advisors, who always keep thinking up on these lines, and these are always interesting things to know. We're always eager to hear all this from veterans like you, especially from the industry. So I would thank all of you present here today. Thank you so much, sir, for taking out time and sharing your valuable thoughts. It is always a pleasure to have you on our discussions. You know, after this discussion, it just clicked my mind that this annual event should not be an annual event. It should be at least semi-annual. I mean, we should regularly have you on platform and hear things from all of you, sir. So thank you so much for making it a great learning for all of us. Thank you so much.